Hey folks, gonna have an update on the little Cavalier Blissfield cooling unit. Sadly, I had an incident today with my laptop and that resulted in me losing a bunch of video. So in a moment I'm gonna cut to the beginning of the video that was lost, which is to do with the condenser fan going back together. But once that short segment of video is done, it's gonna be back right here. All right, folks. This thing has been sitting overnight with the vacuum pump running after getting its paint job yesterday. And it's time to put some refrigerant vapor in there. I'm not going to try to charge it because it's not complete to run yet, but I don't want to leave it under vacuum and allow air to get in the system. So I'm going to isolate the low side valve to the vacuum pump. Turn that off. And then I'm gonna put a can of refrigerant on the can tap. Just hooked up here. Tap a can of refrigerant there, you can see the thing. Now I'm gonna hold it upright so the airspace in here is hooked up to the hose. And that will let me purge any kind of air out of the yellow hose. And if there's any non-condensable gas in that can for some reason, it will be gone. So now, I'm just going to put some vapor in the system. That wasn't enough. Needs more. I want this to stay in the positive pressure side, not in vacuum. Once the gauge is closed. That's 10 pounds. That's probably enough right in there. Yeah. So that way when I disconnect the hose up there from the gauge port, the service port, I know that air won't go back in. And we'll have a charge that's as close as possible to only refrigerant once the job's done. It'll eliminate a lot of potential problems down the road. The port with the gasket. All right, now to move on with further reassembly. Just gonna do a little work to this fan motor here, the condenser fan. Start out by hitting it with the brake cleaner on the back. Then scrub it down, see if we can see any markings under there. Looks like a GE. Keep cleaning that up. I'm going to use the nylon brush, try to get all the oil and stuff off, and then going to punch a hole in this oil reservoir to re-oil the oil felt, and I'll show that in a minute. These motors are generally really reliable, except when the cable gets broken right here. So That's the thing I've got to be careful of, is not to break the cable off. It's still pretty flexible, but I worry about that. Some of the ones have plug-on spade type terminals, then you don't have to worry, but this one is directly wired. Just a touch cleaner. You can see on there now, got a part number. 115 volt, 60-50 cycle, 4-pole, or 0.4 amp, then we have 4 watt, and that 4 watt is the output power, and now 4 pole clockwise. And of course, high impedance protected. That means it, even when it's stalled, it doesn't draw enough current to burn itself out. So it could sit there with something jammed in the fan for days, and as soon as you remove the obstruction, it starts right back up. So get on with the show here, and put an oil port in this. So this is the bracket for the fan motor, and it goes like that in the bracket. So what I want to do is figure out what's going to be the top when it's mounted. And of course there's no way to make the writing right side up, so it just has to be like this. So probably something like that. And then this is the rear of the condensing unit, so if I put an oil port right there, it'll be accessible even when it's all together from the back of the machine. So I'm going to mark that spot and put the port right there. So I've got a punch here with very keen points on it. I'm going to put it onto that spot and attempt to knock a hole in that. Like so. I'm going to enlarge it a little bit. Now I'm going to go with this this very tapered punch and try to open it up. I want it opened up enough so that I can put a rubber plug in it once it's oiled. Almost big enough. I think that's getting there. So we have the oil port now, and I got the 3-in-1 electric motor oil. It's very important that this is the blue can, not the red can, because the red one is penetrating oil and it evaporates. This is a long-term kind of oil. So I'm gonna stick that down in there and inject quite a bit, because this thing's got a lot of oil felt in it. And that will go in there and saturate that and give it another 100 years worth of oil. And again, I will have a permanent rubber plug. I'm just going to put this little taped up plastic pin in there to seal it for now. And then I'll get a real plug later. So that motor is ready for a little fresh coat of paint. Got the wiring all preserved and covered in sleeving all the way down to here, where it's protected against air getting to it, deteriorating it. And then it's going to be terminated to a new cord right there where the connection points are. Little oil port there. So I think this fan is ready to go back on the unit. So I needed to email a picture to somebody, just a basic still picture. And I took a picture with the camera and put it in the laptop memory card to download it. And without any kind of warning or any kind of low battery notice, the laptop just turned off. Did it while I was resizing the picture. And then I plugged it into shore power and turned it back on. And of course, at that point, all of my memory card was empty. So sorry about that. I apologize, but it is what it is. So, bad news aside, this is, I believe, ready for charging. The thermostat, I put that in the sonic cleaner with the cover off of it and cleaned it internally and lubricated it and got it all ready to go. Works nicely. Have the thermostat cap tube arranged and put in there. Have a new cable. Goes in to the inside of this evaporator. And that takes care of the thermostat and the evaporator motor. And put this little junction block on for the incoming power in the parts of the unit. This cable is going to go to the door for the power for the coin box. And this is, of course, the input power cord. Now, the original junction block was a molded thing like that. I'm not particularly fond of those because they're, you know, anything goes wrong and it's got to be cut up and it's spliced. But with the junction box, if one cable goes bad, it can be changed. And you probably notice we have the, I guess, Naugahyde fan shroud on there. I don't know what the reasoning behind having that fake leather grain on it is. All that cabling is done there. Everything's hooked up on this side. You can see internally there where those connections are. That is heat shrink with hot glue seal inside it, so it's fully waterproof. That could be actually underwater and be fine. So condensation from the evaporator is not going to hurt that at all. And we've got a brass screw there where it's grounded. And this evaporator motor, I had taken it apart and I found out that water had been getting in it. So don't know if you can see, it's kind of shiny looking there. I've put a film of silicone caulk on it around all the seams so that the water dripping from these cooling fins isn't going to fall down in it. And it's looking ready to go. So, remember, this thing ran, but it didn't cool. It was empty, the refrigerant. So this will be the first time it's going to hopefully cool, and this is where we'll find out if there's blockages in the cap tube or something. So hopefully not. So stand by, and I'm going to get it all hooked up to power and get the gauges on it. We're going to see if it's going to cool. Okay, it should be all on screen there. Hooked up to the kilowatt. Everything's powered off, and the thermostat up here is powered off. I'm going to hook up the gauges to it so that we can see what kind of pressure's in it. If you remember, I put refrigerant vapor in it to be sure that it didn't take on moisture while I was doing other work. So in theory, when I hook the gauges up here, we ought to see some pressure. I'm going to try to hold the gauges in front of the camera where we can see the low side go up possibly. Yeah, remember I just put a little bit in there. It went up. That's good. Got the can on there. I'm going to purge out the hose. That's good. And then I'll go ahead and let it take in vapor and kind of equalize. Oh, a little liquid went in. That ain't going to hurt. Not running. I wish the camera had a better kind of dynamic exposure where it wouldn't swamp out on the gauges like that. Turn the exposure down manually. So we've got about 55 PSI in there. So I went ahead and took the camera off the tripod so I could move around and show different things better. Now one thing I did, I made a back cover for the evaporator fan, because I'm pretty sure that for the right airflow it needs to have this covered up like it would when it was in the cabinet. So with this off, I'm going to turn on the power to the unit. That should be the evaporator fan only. Turn on the thermostat, the compressor ought to start, and we should see that low side going down. So here goes nothing. Down really low, so I'm going to give it some more vapor. Feel a slight bit of warmth there. No cooling yet. Everything sounds very nice. Back on the tripod. Of course, you can see right there, now that's covered in frost. ahead and give it some more refrigerant. Just pulled almost into a vacuum on the low side. Most of these, they don't take a really lot of charge, so I got to be real careful. I don't want to go too far with it. But being the type of system it is, it really shouldn't have a hard frost like that, especially running in open air like it is. The whole thing should be sweated, but not really frosted like that. Discharge line's a little warm. Our current draw. Get that frost on there, it's getting thick. To get the thermometer and put there in the evaporator outlet. I went and got a pan of warm water to help boil off the refrigerant out of the can. Set that in there to help get the charge going in faster. See the compressor current going up because it has more vapor to compress. You can probably see the frost starting to melt off right there. You might think, oh, it's not cooling as well, but actually what's happening is instead of this first few inches of tubing being very, very cold, more of this coil is actually cooling, but the temperature's not as low. But there's a whole lot more heat energy being transferred that way. We want the whole coil to have active refrigerant boiling action going on, absorbing heat. And for that to happen, it's going to have a higher pressure on the suction. And therefore that actual temperature won't be as cold, but the overall heat transfer will be a lot higher. Feeling the condenser, all the hairpins on here are warm, except for maybe the last two are cool. Starting to see water drip. Air's coming out cool. I'm going to give it a few minutes to stabilize and I'll cut back to it if anything exciting happens. She's been running about 15 minutes, I would say. Trying to dial in the charge amount. I think I've pretty well got it. Running 35 psi on the low side. And I don't know if you can see it, but there's beads of water on all these cooling fins. And the beads of water come out here on the return line. And you see where it becomes the heat exchanger as the cap tube on it. It's sweated right into this area and then it's not anymore. And the reason for that, the liquid refrigerant from the condenser is warm. just barely warm, but it's warm. And that warm liquid is going through the capillary tube that's attached to the side of the return line, and it's transferring heat from the liquid into the returning gas. So by the time the gas reaches the compressor over here, it's just ambient. And that's what you want. Because we have the maximum possible load on the system, it's taking that the greatest distance through the condenser before it changes from a gas back to a liquid. All these are warm, the same temperature more or less up here, just these last two are cooler. That means the maximum amount of that refrigerant is circulating in the system, not trapped in the condenser. So this again is a worst case scenario for it to have an overcharge and be, you know, flowing liquid back to the compressor. And as you can see, it's pulling a lot of moisture out of the air. It's very warm and humid today here. And the discharge air temperature is about 55 degrees, which doesn't sound like much when you consider it's about 80 degrees in here, or maybe a little more. It's actually doing a whole lot of work. The blower is really powerful for a little cooling unit like this. And it would need that air to circulate back in and get cooler and cooler with each pass to reach, refrigerator temps. But just running it out here in open air like this is a real stress test on it. But, I mean, comparatively, that, by feel, being that I'm in a warm room here and this is just a single pass through here, it's way, way colder than an air conditioner would blow in here. So, again, I'm going to stand way up here. I'm sure you can hear the wind noise profoundly. That blower is quite effective. See the condensation falling. Definitely pretty quiet. Well, I'm satisfied with the charge amount, enough that I'm going to take this gauge off and put the port cap back on there, make sure it's got a gasket in it. I'm just happy to see this cooling unit working. There's no telling how long it's been since it functioned. And running free air in an 80 plus degree room with high humidity and dropping the air temperature more than 20 degrees in a single pass, in my opinion, that's pretty good. That's pretty stout. And we're drawing 522 watts, which we can do the math later, but it's got two fan motors plus a compressor. It's supposed to be a 1/4 horsepower. So it's doing probably a little more than it's rated to do. But again, right now it's under a lot of stress because it doesn't have a cabinet around it. Well, to help not stress test it too long, I put this paper towel on there to restrict it. That'll simulate it being in a cabinet. Down to 40 degrees now. 5.22 amp current draw. Total runtime at this point has been about an hour, I would say. Even with that covered up, there's still a lot of air coming through. A lot of water. Hard to believe there's that much water in the air, you know? There's a lot of real scientific ways you can determine the charge amount on a system like this. But being that it's a capillary tube system, everything is dependent on the operating conditions. And you could use all the instrumentation in the world and get this completely optimized for the way it is now. In other words, running open air in an 83 degree room with a perfectly clean condenser, put it in a cabinet and it's not going to be right again. So it's all a compromise with the cap tube system. And I'm just trying to get this charge amount the best I can get it with it like it is, sort of predicting what might happen when it goes in the cabinet. So that's why I keep checking to see if there's any, how far the cooling effect is going down the heat exchanger, because I want to be sure that it's not going back to the compressor. It's just a learned thing. I can't really explain it any better than that. That's one of the reasons that a lot of folks don't like to work on this kind of stuff, because there's really no manual to go by that tells you step by step what to do. You have to look at the unit, feel it, listen to it, look at gauges, take temperatures, and actually troubleshoot. It's not going to give you a warning code on a display to tell you to change this part. Some ice on there. All right, so I'm going to shut this thing down and call it a day. Listen for the shutdown here. Actually, I'm going to turn it off with this. See if it cuts off before off, if it's cold enough. Nope, here we go for off. Power down the fan. Alright guys, thank you so much for watching and commenting and liking my videos. It means a whole lot to me, and for that I thank you. Really, when I started making videos about my tinkering, I never really thought many people would enjoy watching this stuff. I thought that, you know, most folks would want to do instead of just watch. It never occurred to me that it would be interesting to more than a few folks, but I'm taken aback and thankful. So again, thanks for watching, and catch you next time.